My guest today is Martine Dowden. Martine, how are you?
Good. How are you guys?
I'm doing really well. I'm missing people like you in person at events that we used to go to.
Oh, yeah. It's been way too long.
Martine, what do you do?
I am a UX UI designer and developer and also CTO of Andromeda. So a lot of hats.
Yeah. And I understand that you work a lot with a product called D3. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, it's a JavaScript library that allows for creating basically data visualizations. So graphs, globes. It's really handy, and basically it's sugar coding for over being able to like on the fly create SVGs. The thing, if you have a general image, right, it's very, very static. You can't interact with the image. You've got the image and you're done. SVG, instead of it being pixel-based or raster-based like a JPEG or a PNG, is all based on functions. So it's not only can it scale infinitely big and infinitely small because it's all lines being drawn via functions, but you can inject code in it to be able to interact with it. So you can have an image that's fully clickable, that's got event, that can respond to events. So you can put buttons, you can put links, you can make it animate, you can do all sorts of things with it.
Very cool. Okay, I interrupted. Please continue.
You're fine. So basically what D3 does is it's a library to help you create those. And it also has a handful of helpful functions. So when you're doing some of the data visualizations, you don't have to rethink of all the calculations and math and algorithms behind placement, for example. It calculates all of that for you, which is really, really nice. So,
is it strictly for web pages or is it for other apps as well?
Well, I mean, it's JavaScript, so anything you can run JavaScript on in some fashion you can use. I mean, there's no reason you can use it to inside of a mobile app, for example, even if it was native. As long as you can use JavaScript, you can use it.
All right, so some of these frameworks like Ionic or Angular.
Oh, yeah. One of the projects I'm using in right now is in Angular, and I can pull it in just fine.
Tell me about some of the features of D3.
There's charts. So basically what's really nice with it is it's hard to use very often because oftentimes something like charts.js or whatever is perfectly fine and has a lot more helpful things. And so D3 ends up being a little overkill for a lot of things, but when you need it, man, it's awesome because it allows you to do like one of the things I'm using it for, I have a project called Lorelink I'm working on right now. It's for tabletop RPG gamers. But so there's a lot of connections between things, right? And so it's really nice. So if you have if the players trigger a specific, you know, event in a specific room, then you're going to have this trap come on and maybe these bad guys come on. And so all these interlink things. So it's really cool to be able to take, you know, maybe an event and be able to show, okay, all of these things kind of like a spider web are connected and might trigger from that. So I've been using it for that because there's a helper function that allows me that basically says, hey, I'm going to give it a list of nodes. I'm going to give it a list of connections and it's going to automatically draw the spider webs based on that. And then I can tailor it and customize it. Like my nodes, our branding for Lorelink is all based on hexagons and the base one is based on circles. That's fine. No problem. I replace the circle with the hexagon. I can make those clickable. I can make those move. But it auto calculates where those can land so that there's no overlap and there's no, you know, and so that everything can show up on the screen, which is super cool, which is something I could do without D3, but it'd be a lot of work versus with it, I can, you know, an afternoon of fiddling and fighting with it and you're good to go, right? So it's a learning curve, but what it can spit out is really nice. Another place I've used it is I took on my, I have a portfolio with all my stuff and all the things I do. And I took all the places I've spoken, and I took, I was able to find JSON that is literally an SVG mapping of the entire world and all the countries. And so what I can do is I can do a spinning globes, color the countries that I've visited, color the countries that I've spoken at. And now I can have this really nice visualization of here's the globe spinning on the page, and you can see all the places I've been, which is super cool. Like those kind of fun. Yeah. Which is something you can do with a dumb image, right? So it allows to do some really, really cool stuff.
I'm trying to picture, you said something about a spider web. What does that look like in terms of data visualization?
So it's got like, to think of a, like, so you have a center point, which is like your a central node, if you will, and you have little lines coming off the nodes, and you've got like each one has little bloops at the end, for lack of a, you know, awesome technical term. So like maybe you have, so if you have a circle at the center, you've got your spikes coming out the center, and then you have another where those are all nodes as well. So they're what's connected to that piece. So maybe one of those nodes also has connections. So that may have spikes coming out of it.
What do the nodes represent?
In the context that I'm using it in, a node might represent a location. Because it's a, you know, for gamers. So maybe it's a room in a castle. And so in that room, you have a trap. And in that room, you have three bad guys. So 1, 2, 3. And then you might have some treasure. So you've got the treasure chest, right? And so you know that these three bad guys, one of them is also associated with this other bad guy, right? So that might be an location. And you know your treasure might have a trap in the treasure chest, so that might have another extension with another trap, right, or whatever. And so you can see very visually all of the things that are going on in this one room that are, like, there's not, like, that would be very difficult to show in text or in tables, right, because you've got all of these connections between all of the things.
Okay, I think what you're saying is that these are the lines represent relationships,
right, between exactly
the nodes, which represent objects.
Exactly.
So, because it's multidimensional, because we have multiple, so many relationships, it doesn't fit well into a two-dimensional table.
Exactly.
Okay. That helps a lot. Thank you. Now, I think one of the things is that it's not just static information, that as data changes on the back end, does that automatically?
Yeah, so, right. So because you've got, so it depends on there's a lot of implementation decisions to make on how you want to refresh your data, right? So in my case, when the data refreshes, I redraw the entire thing. But there's some for that specific visualization. I have another one where slightly different, where I have, so for each, so if you think of a castle has rooms, and inside of the, or maybe a castle has three levels, and then in those three levels, there's rooms, right? And so I can show like the parent-child relationship all the way down. And so what I do is I have the outer circle might represent the castle, and then inside there's three circles for three levels, and inside of each level, there's a circle for each room, that so that you can show where your concentration of things are, and where, and like it might remind you, hey, why is this level empty? I forgot to put my rooms, right? And so on that one, when I refresh, I simply redraw that specific circle instead of trying to redraw the entire thing, because it's a lot more, because what, it's not as easy as just adding back in a singular element like you can do in HTML, where you can just say, hey, I need an extra paragraph tag. Let me just shove an extra paragraph tag. My content will push down, right? SVGs are fixed position based. There's not quite that responsive element to them like there is in HTML. If you're going to tell them, here's my XY coordinate where I want you to put these things, whatever it is, whether it's a box, whether it's a circle. And so you have to figure out, okay, if I put this element here, all of these things have to move, otherwise they're going to overlap and I can't see them anymore, right? So it's a matter of figuring out when you're refreshing your data exactly what you need to recalculate. So how far down do you need to, or how far back up on the SVG scale do you need to recalculate? Are you just, so there's some things where if you're doing maybe maybe some kind of like top-down hierarchy where you might be able to not redraw the whole thing because you're just adding to the bottom and you just keep going down into infinity. But some things you kind of have to because you're having to push other things out of the way. And since everything is fixed positions, you can transition it and move it. You don't necessarily have to like get rid of the node and redraw everything. But you still have to push everything to their new location. So it really just depends on how complex of a visualization, what that data refresh looks like. It just like it like most everything in tech, it depends.
Yeah, there's very little dogma.
Right, exactly.
What does the data on the back end look like? What are you binding to? Are those arrays? Are they databases on disk or what?
JSON objects. I work a lot with Firebase. So generally what I do is like that Lorling project is basically an Angular app that talks to Firebase. So I have a set of Angular services that talk to Firebase, and then the Angular service will transform my data from Firebase into the nice neat JSON object that I need to pipe into D3, and then that renders to the screen. So it's kind of like trying to think of, you know how jQuery used to have these plugins where you just gave it JSON object and it spit something out on the screen? Very kind of like
jQuery
that.
UI, you mean?
Yeah. Kind of like that in a lot of ways, where it's just a matter of converting the data to what the specific D3 function expects.
Well, interesting. So it doesn't really matter what the backend data store is like. What D3 expects is JSON. As long as you can convert to JSON, that's what you need to do. And the JSON is in memory.
Right. Exactly.
So that, it's probably, how fast is it? How responsive is it?
It's pretty fast. I mean, it's all math. And really, I mean, browsers and computers are really good at math. So it's pretty fast. Where it gets a little bogged down is just like a lot of things on the web is the amount of data that you try to throw at it. Okay. So if you've got, you know, if you're trying to display 5,000 nodes on your screen, you're probably going to end up seeing some lag, right? It just like everything else, it has to do with the amount of data you're throwing at it. And how, like, because you're doing a lot of math to convert into the object that D3 expects, sometimes some optimization on that transformation of data between whatever your database is giving you to what it expects, there's sometimes some optimization you can do there based on how you know you're doing your conversion, looping over it three times instead of once, those sorts of things. But for the most part, it kind of follows the same rules as standard web, where don't throw too much data, like excessive amounts of data at it, because I mean you're still drawing nodes to a DOM, and there's an upper limit that browsers are built for, right?
Sure. And also these are done client side, right? The computer you're working on has its memory limits as well.
Exactly.
Is D3 capable of doing mathematics like calculations and aggregations, or is that something you have to do ahead of time when you create your JSON?
Some of them do, because they do like, there's graph. Well, no, because even the graphs, you're telling it what your points and what your histograms are, whatever what your bars are. So I don't. Everything I've ever done with it, like I gave it the data I wanted it to represent already in the form it needed to be represented in. It wasn't doing, it wasn't going to run my stats for me if I'm trying to like show a set of statistics and all that. It wasn't going to do that for me.
You would do that ahead of time when you create the data.
I'm not saying it can't. I'm saying that I haven't done it.
Okay. Well, that tells me it's probably the simplest way to do it, because as a developer, you're probably like me. You find the simplest way and then you implement that.
Right. Yep.
Tell me a little about the development steps. You know, what do I have to do to get started using D3?
It's generally, but you're going to import there's a Java, you know, a JavaScript file, D3. It's on NPM. Get to it from CDN, NPM, pick your yarn, pick your poison, right? However you import stuff. And then at that point you have the D3 functionality. And so at that point you can either there's a couple extensions and plugins based on what people have already built. If you like something that, because they have a library of examples and stuff, so you can just pick something that somebody already built and pipe your data in and go forth. Or you can, at that point, you have all the functionality you need to start building out your own and to kind of, so it's, you know, D3, give me an SVG. Okay, D3, give me this. You add this, do this function, do this, and so on and so forth. So the same way you would call, you know, a regular, like the same way you would start adding things to, adding nodes the hard way in JavaScript to the DOM and saying, you know, DOM create element, blah, blah, and then, you know, append, blah, blah. You're doing the exact same thing. It's very much back to the good old DOM manipulation days.
Okay. So import a library and just start writing JavaScript that.
Yep, pretty much.
Okay. Yep. Oh, that sounds simple.
Yeah.
If I'm brand new to it, where's a good place to get started?
So there's a number of like example sets and everything. One of them is D3 Graph Gallery. What I like about that one is, and here I can give you the link in the chat if you want to attach it to something later. But it's got, I like is that examples of what you can do, because like it can do so many things, right? That it's kind of like, it gives you an idea of what you might use it for.
Okay. That sounds a little overwhelming, all these different examples and types of visualizations.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, but once you get into it, it's really fun. Really.
There are tutorials on here that a novice.
Yes. So if you pick a specific visualization, it'll show you an example of how it's rendered.
Step by step. I like it a lot.
Yeah.
Directive.
Not so much a step by step as much as here's the code of how this was done. Hope you know how to read JavaScript. But
it says step by step. I was just reading.
yeah. They're very, very, they assume you already know JavaScript quite well.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Are you doing speaking now that we're starting to come out of this craziness?
So I'm staying, right now everything that I'm planning on is still virtual. Because children, unvaccinated children, and so until they're all vaccinated, I'm all the last holdup is vaccinated. Really, I say all like I have a plethora, but there's one holdup that is too young to get vaccinated. So until he's vaccinated, I'm gonna stay virtual. But once the whole family is there, then I'll probably open up to more in persons. But for now,
that's sensible. What's coming up virtually for you?
Codepalooza for sure. There's a JavaScript one. Reliable Dev, which is coming right up. I'm trying to think what else. Right now, I think that's the big two that I'm slated for. I have a couple user groups and things like that I've been working and doing as well, but been trying to, because I know a lot of people are kind of over the online thing, so it's been nice because finding opportunities for online hasn't been too bad. So
yeah,
it's kind of sticking to the online world.
It's the best we could do for a while, but as I said, mm-hmm. I really miss getting out and interacting with people, folks like you, and there's nothing like in-person interaction.
I do have to say it has given me a lot of opportunity to interact with some people I wouldn't have had a chance to, simply because of distance. Like there are a number of user groups that I've spoken at, or even when we were running the GDG in Indianapolis, Mike and I are no longer doing that. But when we managed to get speakers from all over the world, which would never have been possible in person, just Very because cool. you're not going to bring somebody in from, you know, halfway across the world for a simple meetup, right?
It's expensive.
Exactly. So there's been a lot of things that would not have happened if not for going all virtual for a while. So, I try to look at the upside.
Me too. Martine, thank you so much for your time. You stay safe.
You too. Thank you. D3 D3 is a great technology, but it can be your best friend or your worst nightmare, depending on how it's implemented.